podcast about authentic people doing beautiful things. Enjoy the show.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to the program this week. Very excited about this week's episode. We're going to begin here in a minute after I talk about a couple of things and after some music. We'll get to our guest and talking about her in a minute with a continuation of a theme from last week's episode and something that I think really has so much to do with the work and the things that I care about and the stuff I'm trying to talk about in the world and so much to do with the show. And that's this notion of how do we build an empathic civilization together? How do we, in this new era, this post-Obama, new Trump era, work together and build coalitions across groups of people that don't necessarily agree on everything? How do, if we're ultra-leftist, how do we reach out to religious and conservative and Christian people and vice versa and try to build society that really is equitable and has opportunity and safety for all? It is my firm belief that it is possible to build an empathic civilization together, and that it doesn't have to be rooted in any one ideological system or another. In fact, all of the historical data shows that if you can create a society that has opportunity, access, and safety for all bodies, then the soul part will flourish on its own, that when people have the ability to engage the matters of spirit, when they're not running for their lives and trying to survive and fend off relentless attack, that they can blossom and respond to the voice of God in that timing and as the deity, and they see fit, we move away from the era of retaliation when we install one ideology over the other and then start that pendulum swinging. And, you know, the guest last week had a lot to say about it in terms of studying ancient peoples and maybe some models for us on how to connect to each other and connect to the land in those ways. In the coming weeks and months, as I promised you, I'm going to have lots of different folks on from a lot of different perspectives. We have some pastors and rabbis coming on, and we're going to try to get some folks from a variety of perspectives to come talk with us about their thoughts on how to build a society that is really based in equity, fairness, justice, and true empathy for one another. I want to play another bit of audio from Jeremy Rifkin's work, The Empathic Civilization. If you haven't seen his TED Talk or read his book, the TED Talks are always an introduction into someone's larger body of work. So I'm going to play the audio, excuse me, but hope that you'll go dive further into Jeremy's work. But I think it really dovetails nicely with the bit I played you last week from Ian McGilchrist about the work that's being done in hemispheric science and a way to sort of understand that and how it relates to the way we perceive the world and then construct these systems, these business and economic systems, educational systems, and so forth, linguistic systems. And Rifkin's point, I'll let him make it, is that if we cannot envision a biosphere where we live in one empathic embrace of one another, and again, I stress this is no kumbaya moment, empathy is developed out of an awareness of one another's true suffering and our right to exist and to be and to grow towards godliness, and that's a word I don't use lightly, and it's a word I don't use specifically. Others do. But I think if people grow towards a specific understanding of godliness, great. If they grow towards a general one in that, we want to encourage them in that walk, in that path. Really, I think the key to life is removing as much coercion as possible for people to pursue their spiritual paths. And I think that's the goal of politics in so many ways. It might be an interesting way to think about it. But I'm going to play the Rifkin piece because I think it goes a little bit along with, a lot of it along with the Ian McGilchrist bit I shared with you last week. And I'll occasionally, as I can, drop these bits into the episode so you can maybe see where I'm coming from and where I'm trying to work to build an integral community where I'm trying to work to reach across these ossified binaries that we've created for ourselves and really try to build communities based on listening and mutual empowerment and respect. I think it's possible, and I think we have some models out there for how to do it. One of the ways to not do it is to suppress aspects of our story and one another's history that are vital in our understanding what our true humanity is. And so our guest this week is somebody who I just couldn't look more up to, Max Dashu from the Suppressed History Archives. Max is going to come on, and in the interview I'll give you a longer introduction to her and her work. But please get over to her site and check out the work she's doing if you are not familiar with her. Once again, you know, I've been saying this, and I don't mean it as a joke, but right wing, left wing, chicken wing, whatever side, quote unquote, you come from, we should strive to have the best and the most reliable and the most complete information about the human story as we possibly can. Anyone who seeks to edit or hide or minimize, what am I even trying to say? I can't even speak this week, but anyone who wants to minimize or otherwise step over some aspect of the human story with this, nothing to see here, folks, move along. Don't be so sure. You know, I had a friend who's a pastor friend of mine come online in a conversation that we were having about you know, this new list that that people who have leftist ideas as professors are going to be put on this new website that folks are talking about. Where students, if they feel the professors have an unfair or leftist agenda, they can post about these professors and their experiences. And everyone's, you know, freaking out about this. And I think, you know, don't freak out about this. Welcome the dialogue. And my friend who's the pastor was like, you know, hey, maybe folks just want an opportunity to talk about when their professors have these biases and how they affect them. And I said, hey, you know, I couldn't agree more. And I'm completely open to that for myself and my own classes and teaching. And I think other professors should be as well. Not for smear campaigns and harassment, but for genuine dialogue in these areas. But I don't think that only professors should be open to this. I think pastors, I think public servants, I think historians, I think all kinds of folks, I guess historians are academics as well, but I think people that present to us our history, people that come to us with things they claim to be true and that they are representing some fundamental component of our collective shared past, you know, I don't think we should just accept anything that comes from these folks without investigating it and really seeing how much of it that they're telling us can be justified and proven. And more important sometimes, what's being left out. And I think the really amazing stuff about Max's work, again, regardless of the side of the political aisle you're on, is that when we have whole swaths of human history that are just left out of consideration because they happen to deal with a conquered or colonialized people, or because they happen to deal with people of our species that have a particular gender or sexual orientation, or for any of the other reasons that dominator culture has decided that all of the various histories, plural, of our species and all of the various ways peoples have pursued this notion of becoming and living into their fullest potential, that many of those can just be disregarded for some kind of dominator singular narrative that all of them can be sort of shoehorned or forced into. I think this is a very violent way to treat one another, and folks have been writing about this forever. I'm thinking about the wonderful work that done by Chimamanda Adichie and others on this very work. So Max Dashu in the Suppressed History Archives, fantastic transformative work. We brought her to Mount Hood Community College where I teach, and she just blew the roof off of the place. Again, just bringing the historical information that has been left out of so many of our compendiums, so many of our accepted histories. And I just think with this information, it can be used. This information is valuable for our quest to understand ourselves, to understand how we got to where we are now, and maybe chart a way forward together. So I know you're going to love the show. We loved having Max on. You're going to have a little music first, and then the Jeremy Rifkin piece that I told you about, talking about the empathic civilization and its relationship to the research being done, including hemispheric research. Then a couple of pieces from Max, giving you some examples of the kind of work she does with Suppressed Histories, and then into our interview. All right, folks, keep your seatbelts fastened. We're heading into a rocky but fascinating time together. Make sure we do it together. Stay here with On the Block Radio over the coming months and years, because we are the spot for transformational dialogue from all sides. All right, we love you much, and we will see you on the other side.
In the last 10 years, there's been some very interesting developments in evolutionary biology, neurocognitive science, child development research, and many other fields, which is beginning to challenge some of these long-held shibboleths that we've had about human nature and the meaning of the human journey. But there is another frame of reference emerging in the sciences, which is quite interesting. It really challenges these assumptions. And with that, the institutions that we have created based on those assumptions, our educational institutions, our business practices, our governing institutions, etc. Let me take you back to the early 1990s, sleepy little laboratory in Parma, Italy, and scientists had a MRI brain scanning machine on a macaque monkey as the macaque monkey was trying to open up a nut. They wanted to see how the neurons would light up. So the monkey's trying to open up the nut, the neurons light up, And just by serendipity, and this is how science sometimes happens, a human being walked into the laboratory, I don't know if it was by mistake, and he was hungry, he saw the nuts and opened up one of the nuts and tried to crack it open. The macaque monkey was totally shocked because who was this invader in his laboratory? And he didn't move, he just gazed at this human trying to open up the nut, just like he had done a few seconds earlier. And then the scientist looked on the MRI brain scanner, the same exact neurons were lighting up when he observed the human being opening the nut as when the monkey opened the nut, and the scientists had not a clue as to what this was. They thought the MRI machine had broken. They then began to put MRI brain scanning machines on other primates, especially chimpanzees with our big neocortex. Then they went to humans, and what they found over and over again is something called mirror neurons. And that is that we are apparently soft-wired, some of the primates, all humans. We suspect elephants. We're not sure about dolphins and dogs. We've just begun. But all humans are soft-wired with mirror neurons so that if I'm observing you, your anger, your frustration, your sense of rejection, your joy, whatever it is, and I can feel what you're doing, the same neurons will light up in me as if I'm having that experience myself. Now, this isn't all that unusual. We know if a spider goes up someone's arm and I'm observing it going up your arm, I'm going to get a creepy feeling. We take this for granted, but we are actually soft-wired to actually experience another's plight as if we are experiencing ourselves. But mirror neurons are just the beginning of a whole range of research going on in neuropsychology and brain research and in child development that suggests that we are actually soft-wired not for aggression and violence and self-interest and utilitarianism, that we are actually soft-wired for sociability, attachment, as John Bowlby might have said, affection, companionship, and that the first drive is the drive to actually belong. It's an empathic drive. What is empathy? It's very complicated. When little babies enter nursery and one baby cries, the other babies will cry in response. They just don't know why. That's empathic distress. It's built into their biology. Around 2.5 years of age, a child actually can begin to recognize himself in a mirror. That's when you begin to mature empathy as a cultural phenomenon. And that is once a toddler can identify themselves, then they know that if they're observing someone else have a feeling, they know that if they feel something, it's because they're feeling it because someone else has it. They're two separate beings. Selfhood goes together with empathic development. Increasing selfhood, increasing empathic development. Around 8 years of age, a child learns about birth and death. They learn where they came from, that they have a one and only life, that life is fragile and vulnerable, and one day they're going to die. That's the beginning of an existential trip. Because when a child learns about birth and death and they have a one and only life, they realize how fragile and vulnerable life is. It's very tough being alive on this planet, whether you're a human being or a fox navigating the forest. So when a child learns that life is vulnerable and fragile and that every moment is precious and that they have their own unique history, it allows the child then to experience another's plight in the same way, that other person or other being, could be another creature, has a one and only life. It's tough to be alive, and the odds are not always good. So if you think about the times that we've empathized with each other or fellow creatures, it's always because we felt their struggle. We have the with the death and empathy and the celebration of life. And we show solidarity with our compassion. Empathy is the opposite of utopia. There is no empathy in heaven. I guarantee you, I'll tell you before you get there. There isn't any empathy in heaven because there's no mortality. There's no empathy in utopia because there is no suffering. Empathy is grounded in the acknowledgement of death and the celebration of life and rooting for each other to flourish and be. It's based on our frailties and our imperfections. So when we talk about building an empathic civilization, we're not talking about utopia. We're talking about the ability of human beings to show solidarity, not only with each other, but our fellow creatures who have a one and only life on this little planet. We are homo empathicus. So here's the question. We know that consciousness changes in history. The way our brain is wired today is not the way a medieval serf's brain would be wired, and their brain wouldn't be the same as the wiring of a forager hunter 30,000 years ago. So the question I asked at the beginning of this study 6 years ago is, how does consciousness change in history? Because I wanted to imagine the following proposition. Is it possible that we human beings who are soft-wired for empathic distress, is it possible we could actually extend our empathy to the entire human race as an extended family and to our fellow creatures as part of our evolutionary family and to the biosphere as our common community? If it's possible to imagine that, then we may be able to save our species and save our planet. And when I say to you tonight, if it's impossible to even imagine that, I don't see how we're going to make it. Empathy is the invisible hand. Empathy is what allows us to stretch our sensibility with another so that we can cohere in larger social units. To empathize is to civilize. To civilize is to empathize. With forager hunter societies, communication only extended to the local tribe and shouting distance. Everyone over in the next mountain was the alien other. So empathy only extended to blood ties. When we went to the great hydraulic agricultural civilization, script allowed us to extend the central nervous system and to annihilate more time and space and bring more people together. And the differentiation of skills and the increasing selfhood not only led to theological consciousness, but empathy now extended to a new fiction. And that is, instead of just associating with one's blood ties, we detribalized and began association based on religious ties. So a new fiction, Jews start to see all other Jews as extended family and empathize with Jews. Christians start to see all other Christians as extended family and empathize with Christians. Muslims, the same. When we get to the 19th century, the Industrial Revolution, and we extend markets now to larger areas and create a fiction called the nation state. And all of a sudden, the Brits start to see others in Britain as extended family. The Germans start to see Germans as extended family. The Americans as Americans. There was no such thing as Germany. There was no such thing as France. These are fictions. But they allow us to extend our family so that we can have loyalties and identities based on the new complex energy communication revolutions we have that annihilate time and space. But if we have gone from empathy in blood ties to empathy in religious associational ties, to empathy based on national identification, is it really a big stretch to imagine the new technologies allowing us to connect our empathy to the human race writ large in a single biosphere? And what reason would we stop here at the nation-state identity and only have ideological empathy or theological-based empathy or tribal-based blood-tie empathy? We have the technology that allows us to extend the central nervous system and to think viscerally as a family, not just intellectually. When that earthquake hit Haiti and then Chile, but especially Haiti, within an hour the Twitters came out, and within 2 hours some cell phone videos, YouTube, and within 3 hours the entire human race was in an empathic embrace coming to the aid of Haiti. If we were, as the Enlightenment philosopher suggested, in materialistic, self-interested, utilitarian, pleasure-seeking, it couldn't account for the response to Haiti. Apparently, 175,000 years ago in the Rift Valley of Africa, there were about 10,000 anatomically modern human beings walking the grasslands, our ancestors. The geneticists located one database woman. It's a database line. Apparently, her genes passed to everyone in this room tonight. The other ladies didn't make it. Gets even more strange. They located a single male. This is a database line for genetics. They call him the Y chromosome Adam. Apparently, a fairly potent guy. His genes passed everyone in this room. So here's the news. 6.8 billion people at various stages of consciousness, theological, ideological, psychological, dramaturgical, we're all fighting with each other with different ideas about the world. And guess what? We all came from two people. The Bible got this one right. We could have come from many. But the point is, we have to begin thinking as an extended family. We have to broaden our sense of identity. We don't lose the old identities of nationhood and our religious identities, and even our blood ties. But we extend our identity so we can think of the human race as our fellow sojourners and our other creatures here as part of our evolutionary family, and the biosphere as our community. We have to rethink the human narrative. If we are truly homo empathicus, then we need to bring out that core nature. Because if it doesn't come out and it's repressed by our parenting, our educational system, our business practice and government, the secondary drives come. The narcissism, the materialism, the violence, the aggression. If we can have a global debate, let it start here from the British Royal Society for the Arts, which apparently you're doing, to begin rethinking human nature, to bring out our empathic sociability so that we can rethink the institutions of society and prepare the groundwork for an empathic civilization.
The wisdom of the ancients. The ancient wisdom. Direct experience of the primordial source, the flow and flicker of spirit moving through us, through earth, water, air, and fire. That luminous source that predates religious dogma and transcends all the rationales for domination and scatters them. The circle of life in which all beings are relatives. The medicine woman, oracles, diviners, and female prophets. In a thousand ways, they told us that women like this didn't exist. That there were medicine men, prophets, priests. That ceremony was men's business. That women belonged in the background. This is a lie. We know better. We remember. And the cultural record remains in rock art and ceramic sculpture, bronzes, and paintings. They show us women moving in ecstasy, incantation, trance dance. Woman Shaman, the movie, pulls back the curtain, bringing you the images and stories of women who chant, dance, and pray with their bodies to deepen and unify their consciousness, to heal and to transform the world. The Wu, rain dancers of ancient China, the Korean Mudang, the Mikogami of Japan, the drummers, dreamers, invokers, shapeshifters, and women who journey in the spirit worlds. The ecstatic priestesses, the firewalkers, the temple women in Kemet, Canaan, Babylonia, Anatolia, Greece, Tunisia, India, Vietnam, Peru. Bird seers, snake power, bear and coyote and wolf medicine. Sacred staffs, mirrors, belts, rattles and drums, medicine bags and baskets. We need this healing power, this wisdom, this expansive vision. It's our birthright. Just to taste the old ways restores women's spirits. And it's medicine for the whole world. In 1939, the Trung sisters led a rebellion of over 80,000 Vietnamese. They seized 65 Chinese fortresses and forced the Mandarins to flee. They had 36 women among their generals, including their mother, and died fighting after 3 years. The Celtic queen Boudica led British tribes in a revolt against the Roman Empire after the rape of her daughters and other injustices in the year 60. They burned London and Colchester to the ground and came close to forcing the Romans out. The Arab queen Zainab or Zenobia of Palmyra fought the Roman legions for years, leading armies on horseback. She routed the invaders the first time and held them off for another 4 years before Syria finally fell. 1,000 years before, Samsi, the female chieftain of the Kidri tribes, led a North Arabian insurrection against the fell Assyrian Empire. Maria Candelaria raised a major Maya revolt against the Spanish after they destroyed a shrine she had built. The colonials crushed the outgunned Maya resistance, but were never able to capture Maria. Gabriela Silang led the Ilocos Rebellion against Spanish rule in 1763 and pulled out some victories. She was captured in a daring attack on a Spanish garrison and went to her execution with calm bravery. In 1791, the old African priestess Cécile Fatimont inaugurated the Haitian Revolution with a vaudou ceremony in the Bois Caiman. Carrying the Loa goddess Ezili Danto, she blessed the rebel leader Boukman with her petrol staff. Anne Wood led a group of other teenagers in fighting off slave catchers. Two of them were slain, and the rest escaped to freedom. Lakshmi Bai, the Rani of Jhansi, led a major insurrection against English rule of India in 1858. Many other women fought the British Empire. In Zimbabwe, Nahanda Nyaka Sikana led the Chimurenga in 1896. The Shona prevailed at first, but after 2 years, Nahanda finally surrendered to save her people from the devastating machine guns. She was defiant up to her last breath on the gallows. Ya Asantewa led the Asante Rebellion of 1900 in Ghana. If you, the men of Ashanti, will not go forward, then we will. We, the women, will. We will fight the white men. We will fight until the last of us falls in the battlefield. Chiu Jin advocated for women's rights and against foot binding and female slavery, asking, "Is it sweet to live lower than cattle?" She led a girls' school, founded a women's newspaper, and was executed for sedition in 1907 for resisting Manchu rule. Carolyn Norton changed English laws that made women legal minors and gave husbands absolute rights over wives' bodies, property, earnings, and children. She got Parliament to reform laws on child custody, marriage, and divorce, with far-reaching effects. Matilda Jocelyn Gage was an activist of the 19th century women's rights movement who was later written out of its history for being too radical. Her inclusive vision embraced African emancipation, Indian sovereignty, labor, and prisoners' rights. Gage also broke new ground in women's history and courageously pointed out the church's role in subjugating women. Anna Julia Cooper spoke out on black women's despairing fight as of an entrapped tigress to keep hallowed their own persons from social violence. She pushed white feminists to overcome caste bias and called on black men to become their sisters' keepers. Cooper urged education for black girls, not the boys less, but the girls more, pointing out what sacrifices black women made for their children's education. She herself earned a doctorate from the Sorbonne at 66. The Lakota writer Gertrude Bonin was also a pan-Indian political activist and an orator who marshaled support for human rights and attacked the corrupt Bureau of Indian Affairs. In 1926, she founded and headed the National Council of American Indians. Kishida Toshiko was the first Japanese woman to speak in public for women's rights and drew crowds. She was once jailed for saying that women's horizons should be as large and free as the world itself. Pandita Ramabai spoke out passionately against child marriage, widow oppression, prostitution, female infanticide, poverty, and caste injustice. She and her brother became public speakers for women's emancipation, and Ramabai began adopting street girls to save them from starvation and pimps, founding a refuge for child widows run by women.
Hey everyone, this is Bob Walter from the Joseph Campbell Foundation. You're listening to On the Block Radio.
All right. right, welcome to the program, folks. This is your host, Andy Gervich. Our guest this week is Max Dashu, founder, of the Suppressed Histories Archives. Max founded these archives in 1970 to research and document women's history from an international perspective. Since then, she's built a collection of 15,000 slides and 20,000 digital images and has created 150 slideshows on female cultural heritages across human history, all with the intent of restoring women to cultural memory. Her work bridges the gap between academia and grassroots education. It foregrounds indigenous women passed over by standard histories and highlights female spheres of power retained even in some patriarchal societies. For over 40 years, Max has presented hundreds of slide talks at universities, community centers, bookstores, schools, libraries, prisons, galleries, festivals, and conferences around North America and the rest of the world, including last year at my college here in the Pacific Northwest, where our students, faculty, and staff are still reeling from it and clamoring for her to come back. Dashu is known for her expertise on ancient female iconography and world archaeology, women shamans, witches, and the witch hunts, mother right cultures, patriarchies, and the origins of domination. Dashu has released two video DVDs, Women's Power in Global Perspective and Women Shaman, the Ancients. Her daily posts on the Suppressed Histories Facebook page are followed by over 137,000 people. She also recently completed the book Witches and Pagans, Women in European Folk Religion, released by Valeda Press. Max Dashu, welcome so much to the program.
Thank you for inviting me.
I was recently reading an article that just came out, I'm wondering if you saw it, about female staffers in the Obama administration in the White House.
Yes.
And a strategy they've come up with that they've called amplification. And this has to do with in staff meetings at the White House, if a female staffer brings something up, regularly they're interrupted by male colleagues who not only interrupt them midway through what they're saying, but then go on to co-opt the idea as their own. And so to fight this, isn't that funny in a Democratic administration that you're dealing with that still?
It's pretty pervasive.
Go ahead. Oh, yeah, absolutely. And so they fight this by when a female staffer brings something up, the other women on the staff will respond and say, "Oh, that's wonderful that," and they'll mention the woman's name and brought this up, and they'll attach the idea to the person who said it and try to sort of support each other and echo their sentiments, and they create this kind of web of support that allows their ideas to not be stolen. And the reason I wanted to start there is that one of the many reasons I wanted to bring you on the show is that this is something that I think. It's unfortunate they have to do this, but it's great that they're doing it. But I think all of us need to do this. I don't think that just women need to do this for each other. I think men and other folks
right.
need to do the same thing. And that's what I'm
right.
hoping we do here in this conversation.
And signal boosting also for white people to speak up around issues of racism. And there's just all kinds of ways in which men are heard more than women when speaking about sexism, and white people are heard more than people of color when speaking about racism. And so, you know, it's just like the responsibility, if you're not in the target group, to signal boost and to really underline the unacceptability of those behaviors.
Yes, and to not
because,
model
you know, they're unconscious behaviors half the time, you know?
Yeah, how so? I mean, you're saying they're unconscious behaviors.
Because people absorb these, you know, just from their earliest years, and it's sort of like the sea we swim in, and so they're not aware of doing that. It's just like internalized misogynies or internalized racism. People aren't aware, and you know, sometimes someone will point out to them, well, you know, you allowed that person to talk longer than that person. You know, there's things that. In the case of men and women, you have studies that have been done over and over again about conversation patterns and men interrupting women. And I see the example that you gave, not listening to them or crediting their ideas to men. Mm. I mean, it's kind of a famous experience among feminists, at least, that, you know, or women who have become conscious, that you would say an idea and you would be ignored, and a couple minutes later some guy would say that idea and everybody's, oh, that's a great idea, let's do that.
Yeah,
and so this is a known pattern.
It's one thing to, we had a guest on the show, Paul Levy, who talked about this indigenous concept of Wetiko, this kind of
pointing to the other as the one who has the sickness, but not being able to see it in oneself. And so when we talk about toxic masculinity, it's one thing to sort of look at active examples of this. It's easy for maybe me to look at a Donald Trump and say, oh, that's an example of toxic masculinity. It's harder for me to look at my own communication patterns with the women in my life and see where I engage in either active or, as you just talked about, passive toxic masculinity, right? By sort of allowing myself to either participate in or stand by while these behaviors are perpetuated.
Right. And the other side of that is the way that women have internalized things so that, you know, women, I mean, the inculcation of deference, female deference, is really far-reaching. And, you know, attached to that are all kinds of unconscious fears based on experience that you will be repudiated if you behave in a really sovereign manner. You know, if you don't behave differentially or if you threaten men in professional positions, for example, in your job, things like that, there are consequences.
Yeah.
And so you learn on really deep levels, maybe not even as a conscious decision, but over time, you accumulate patterns of how to deal with that in order to minimize the static, you know, if not the outright danger in some cases.
It's it's ridiculous how, ubiquitous this is. My wife and I were watching, of all things, on NBC last night, this show, America's Got Talent. And this ridiculous talent show thing that they have on, and the four hosts of the show are four celebrities: Howie Mandel, Mel B from the Spice Girls, Heidi Klum, and Simon Cowell. And one of the things we noticed immediately is that even on a silly show like this, when the judges went to speak, any time one of the two women judges spoke, either one of the male judges would interrupt them within a sentence and a half of what they were trying to say.
Yep.
It was remarkable. I mean, it's a silly TV show, but you're seeing the pattern. It goes from the White House all the way to to this show. I mean, it's remarkable.
Gail Spender writes about these studies where if women talk as much as a third of the time, they're perceived as taking more than their share of their conversational space.
Wow.
And, you know, there's just, and this is by both men and women. So the amount of room allowed to females in, you know, social interactions is constrained.
You know, when I look at go ahead, continue, I'm sorry.
One other thought, because, that was one thing that was going around, was this article about the Obama administration and the fact that the women consciously, see, the key to the success of this was not that an individual did it, but that there was a group solidarity to the strategy. And what this reminds me about is something else I saw going around, which is about the bonobos.
Yes.
And it really underlines the importance of female solidarity. And, you know, there can also be male solidarity for, you know, female equality. That's another piece. But, you know, in the case of the bonobos, it's female solidarity that prevents sexual assaults. And, you know, just sets a tone that, you know, and I see this also with humans, you know, that if you have female solidarity, if you have a culture where females do not consciously separate themselves from each other, because I think that's sort of a witch hunt culture pattern. It's dangerous for women to be aligned with other women. And we saw the stigma that it became attached to feminism because of using that very strategy. You know,
the bonobo study you mentioned is fascinating because, you know, we've known about, you know, a little bit about bonobos and some of their behaviors, and we know that there are elder females in the group. I almost said women. There's an anthropologist friend of mine in town here who refuses to make a distinction between the word woman and female when he's talking about chimpanzees and bonobos. I'm wondering if
I'm having a little trouble hearing you.
Oh, I was saying I have an anthropologist friend in town who won't make the distinction, but when he talks about bonobos, he says the bonobo women do this, and his colleagues have tried to ask him to say the bonobo females, but he won't do that. But that, I guess that's a separate question. But this study talks about exactly that, female solidarity, about one of the primary way that the bonobos, the women or females, are able to fend off male aggression is by binding together and working in groups against it. It's really remarkable.
Yeah, so there's a couple levels to that, because there's the actual individual cases where you have women who act out that kind of solidarity, and then there's the deeper cultural level where that's okay, where that's not treated as a threat, but it's a normal part of being, is that you have this these sodalities of women, you know, that they have this context for joining together with other women.
When
you know, for women's concerns.
My study of Judaism, one of the things I know when the when the Red Tent movement was going recently, and you know, and certainly if you have any specific thoughts to that, speak to it. But one of the things just about the concept that I really liked was that this Judaic notion that for all intents and purposes was meant to exile women or set them apart as quote unquote unclean actually became a space where women were able to actually bond. And help, at least within you know, the patriarchy of early Judaism, or I guess late Judaism, not early Judaism. Early Judaism was still matrilineal.
Yeah. There's a whole discussion about those cultural politics.
So, what led you to start the Suppressed History Archives?
I left college because women's history was literally a joke, and there was no women's studies at that time. And so it just seemed really impossible as a lone woman, in a leading college to try and do that. You know how the hierarchy works in academia and how much of it is based around prestige behaviors. And this was not a prestigious thing to do. So I just kind of cleared out of there and began working as an independent scholar. And I didn't say, I will found an archive. But it was something that kind of grew and accumulated naturally. I just began reading everything I could. And these were the days of card catalogs.
Yeah.
Where you really didn't... It's like, oh gosh, Google... The search engines are so amazing because you can find so much now. But at that time, you're in the card catalog and you're looking up a woman. And it's not a very long listing. And it's like housewife, fashion, you know, just all these really stereotypical things.
Right.
All very white dominated. It's, you know, just shot through with all kinds of cultural assumptions and narrow definitions. And so I wanted to really cast a wide net and look at a global level, basically to see, where are women free? Is there any place on this planet where women are free? You know, because looking around in my world, I didn't see it.
Yeah.
I didn't see that happening. And so I was doing this research and really looking a lot at as an indigenous society.
Yes.
Because, you know, I thought, well, if the society is not a war-based, class-based, you know, hierarchical system, that would probably have a greater probability of having some kind of, you know, respect and honor and freedom for women. And that proved out to be true in a great many cases. I mean, not to say that all indigenous societies, you know, I mean, there are patriarchal indigenous societies as well. So that's a whole discussion about the historical process of patriarchy developing. Because, you know, some people start from the standpoint, it's always been like this, and therefore, there's really nothing we can do about it. Because
right.
That's just how humans are. And that's not at all what I'm seeing in my historical research. But I had to really kind of test various hypotheses and just research and see what kinds of patterns emerged, you know, looking at a wide range of societies.
Yeah, I think... Oh, go ahead, continue, sorry.
Go.
I love that it's the Suppressed Histories plural archives, because you're not...
Yeah.
It's not history in terms of, again, that patriarchal notion, that Yahwistic idea of there's one story to be told, and it's the story of wars and kings and conquerors. But you're looking
right.
at these marginalized.
Yeah, and especially because it's multi-ethnic, you know. I mean, there's a lot of different layers and histories.
You talk on your page, and I really recommend the listeners get over to the archives. There's just a treasure trove of information there. The gallery, they can see some of your slide presentations. They can order the DVDs or the book. We'll leave all this info on our website, too. And they can also make a donation to the archives and can contact with you about bringing you possibly to speak at an event. But one of the things you talk about is having a global perspective on women's history, and that's what you've been speaking to now. And I guess if you can just say a little more about why that's important, this global perspective. What does it show us?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think you can really understand the problem of patriarchy or really any great social question like that without having a really global understanding.
Yeah.
That, you know, of all the continents and also all the historical periods. Because, you know, we can look at how things stand now and the world is just being riven. Male domination, racism, all these things are going on. But, you know, what did it look like in some of these places 500 years ago? You know, what did North America look like in 1491? what did it look like in the year 100? You know, even that time framework is a Eurocentric construct.
Of course.
Christian calendar. But just to be able to look and something, starting with archaeology, and see the really different configuration of human cultures where you're not talking about mass markets, there's no standing armies, there's villages, there people are creating crafts that are part of the life support network. You know, maybe they're trading a little bit, but no massive networks, economic networks like that.
Yeah.
And so it's very locally based. And in a lot of these, you know, Neolithic farming villages, the primary iconography is female. And not in the way that we see in our advertising media where women are used as bodies draped over cars to sell whatever it was, you know, that, that the company wants to sell. Or, you know, pouting into the camera, all the pornified stuff that has become so naturalized to people that they don't even see it. You know, because it just, we're just constantly awash. But instead, very centered self-portrait kind of art that women are creating icons of femaleness out of their own concepts, not from somebody else's agenda to sell or to exploit anything like that, you know. And so that is really pervasive on the planet, is to see these clay figurines, stone, ivory, bone, where there's representation of perhaps ancestral women, you know, ancestral mothers might be part of what's going on there, because they are found in sacral contexts, including burials. And, you know, we just have to pull back all these layers and look at the historical developments and compare. And that's where the international perspective is so crucial. Because one of the questions I get all the time is people say, well, when did patriarchy begin? And there's no answer to that in a linear sense, because I always answer that with, where on the planet are you talking about?
Yeah.
Because the timeline in Mesopotamia is very different, or, you know, say in southern Mediterranean, or, you know, wherever you are.
Right.
It's very different than if you're looking at some parts of, like, say, the eastern foothills of the Andes, where there are matrilineal societies going, you know, right along, or Highland Vietnam, or places that we don't ever get taught anything about in the histories that are shown to us.
Yeah, you know, if I can ask you about Neolithic and Paleolithic figurines again, you mentioned a couple there. I just read an article, again, in preparation for speaking with you about another one of these figurines that was found at Çatalhöyük in Turkey. That is extremely, exactly like you're talking about, not at all conforming to these modern notions of femininity being this, you know, dainty, weak, male gaze. None of this stuff is happening. We have these rooted, grounded figures that speak to, I remember what Maria Gimbutas said, you know, these sex goddesses were goddesses of regeneration, right? Which is a very
different
thing.
You know, she's very centered in herself. This is from Çatalhöyük.
Yes.
And, on the, we've been having a discussion about that on the Suppressed Histories page over on Facebook, you know, because all the same questions come up. I mean, a lot of the women are looking at it and they're saying, wow, look at her, she's beautiful. And there's a few women who are saying, oh my gosh, are you kidding? She's fat, you know, how could she be beautiful? You know, all that, all those, again, conditionings.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's also conversations because there are sort of some academic men who are coming on and saying, well, you know, you can't call them goddesses, they're magical fertility totems. And, you know, there's this whole war over what do we call these things?
Sure.
How do they get named? Who determines that? You know, and even in male academia, this is not, I mean, I know that, like, the Europeans, for example, have no problem calling them mother goddesses or, you know, goddesses.
Or Venus is another controversial word, yeah?
Yeah, the Venus word I don't like because, you know, this is actually a French aristocratic man who used this term for something that was found on his land.
Oh.
And it really brands these as sex figures.
Fascinating, okay.
And, you know, so, again, attaching assumptions, because Venus, coming out of the Roman culture, you've got all the statues of Venus, and she's, you know, the modest Venus, and she's covering her genitals, but everything's pretty much there for view.
Sure.
And it's a pornified view.
Yes.
And, you know, maybe really ancient layers of that goddess, Venus, right, in pre-patriarchal times, maybe there was something else going on with that goddess, but... you know, it's a preformed framework that tends to perpetuate the same cultural assumptions that we have going on. And another of those is you'll see people say, well, and especially men, who will say, oh, well, these are Neolithic porn.
You know, I just read a Smithsonian article that said exactly that. Prehistoric porn is what it was titled, and it was a picture of the Willendorf statue.
They've been saying it for about 20 years or so. And before that, like, you know, the archaeologists were challenging the idea that these were sacred images, like in the 60s, Peter Uccle and some of the other writers that talked about this. Their idea was that these were dolls or toys.
Wow.
You know, but in each case, those interpretations are really loaded with a lot of assumptions, because what kind of societies are these that we're talking about?
Right.
In the case of Chatal Huyuk, well, you had Mellart and Gimbutas talking about it and saying, wow, women had really high standing in this society. The current excavator, Ian Hodder, really misrepresents Gimbutas' whole approach to this by saying, well, she's been proven wrong by our excavations because it was an egalitarian culture.
Oh, but, boy.
See, that's exactly what Gimbutas was saying.
That's exactly,
that
yes.
Societies were egalitarian. And therefore, that means, you know, it's by contrast with ours, where, you know, it's male supremacy. In these cultures, you have female spheres of power, you have male spheres of power, and you have a cooperative society, which is, however, the sacral culture is really based around the mother, you know, the female ancestor, or as she would say, the goddess, you know. And so this gets very fraught, and it's all about who has the authority to interpret. So even though Gimbutas had a massive knowledge of the archaeological record, I mean, she had translated all these Eastern European excavations, and, you know, she really knew the Bronze Age, she knew the Neolithic. Nevertheless, for her to interpret was considered beyond the pale, and so you will see her being repudiated. And I don't necessarily agree with all her interpretations,
sure.
But to see the backlash against her right to interpret at all, and to see her being not engaged on the documentation she assembled, but instead in polemical ways that don't really address that at all, it's a really good example of how you can be a very qualified woman, and yet you're going to be a target.
Yeah, and she did
not,
this research. She was at these digs. I mean, she did most of this research primarily, and so it's remarkable when people attack her for not knowing what she was talking about.
Yeah, and the other part about her is, and she did archaeological digs. She did all this research. She read massive amounts of things in 16 languages. But the I forgot what I was going to say. She
studied folk songs, too, I know.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say,
okay.
Is that she had this massive knowledge of orature, you know, the folk traditions of various European societies, and in her own Lithuanian culture, it gave her a basis for interpreting from a different direction than the standard academic, linear, objectivist. You can't really be objective, and it really is objective. It's all standpoint, right?
Right.
But, you know, she brought that to the work, and she brought her knowledge of the domination-based Bronze Age societies to the work. And so, you know, this is, of course, what caused her so much trouble, because ultimately she started going in this direction saying, these societies are a different paradigm than the Bronze Age hierarchical military-based cultures.
That's
or
really
trade-based. You know? And, she, you know, she saw the centrality of the female iconography. And, you know, this is something I found, too, because I had just dropped out of college, and I'm looking through all these archaeological reports, and I'm seeing, wow, the further back in time you go, the more prominent the female iconography becomes. And also the quality of that iconography is something very different than the Greco-Roman art that we're all exposed to in our educations.
Boy, that is really true.
It's very present. It's very solid. And if you look, for example, in South America or Central America, in some of the early layers, you know, talking about first millennium BCE, in that time period, you find that, you know, the whole aesthetic, first of all, of what female is being defined as is very, it's solid, it's strong, it's stocky, it's not shrinking violet, there's no pouting, wilting, you know,
right,
porn-type images.
Uh-huh.
They're very centered.
Yeah, you don't have the tilted head. Right, all of those things that show weakness and kind of contingency. Yeah, it's all very... Go ahead, continue, I'm sorry.
And so, you know, my position is we need to know about that massive human heritage, the whole spectrum of it, because it has not been shown to us. And the archaeology of Sudan and Zimbabwe, you find some of these same kinds of images. And each region has its particular styles. But this is not in our education, and as a result, it becomes very easy to convince people that, you know, and I see this all the time when we get into arguments on the Suppressed Histories page on Facebook, where people will respond to an account of genocide or patriarchy and say, well, humans have always been this way, and there's nothing we can do about it. But, in fact, you know, as I like to say, the differences between the Hopis and the Nazis do count very much. You know, there's a whole range of different kinds of cultures that humans have had.
Yeah, and that kind of inevitability, not only is it not, it's kind of sloppy scholarship and it's not true, but like you said, it drains us of any kind of hope or ability to see a path forward. I mean, it was Margaret Mead who faced this when she was trying to show that warfare wasn't an inevitability, but that there were indeed still cultures on the earth that knew nothing of it.
Yeah, and sometimes I see it being used to let us off the hook or to let someone off
the
hook. You know, it's just like, well, there's nothing can be done, really. Because, you know, this is just pervasive. And I think a lot of our education goes to that. What, you know, so then the assumptions about even who men are become, you know, it varies culturally so much. I mean, the importance of culture as an ingredient in socializing to domination is really massive. And you could also take it from the converse principle, and going back to the bonobos, is that in many cases, you know, you have a cultural efforts by women to socialize men against those kinds of behaviors. And some theorists have talked about the incest taboo, for example, as being an attempt of females to protect the young from male predation. You know,
you see it in narrative, too, the fact, you know, things like A Thousand and One Nights, these stories of women trying to use narrative to heal male psychosis towards violence against women. It's really, really something. Just to make a comment quickly, and then I want to ask you one question, and we'll go to break. Just back on the figurines, two figurines that I'm extremely interested in, the Barakat Ram and Tauntaun figurines, go back 250,000 to some say 600,000 respectively. And I wonder, I know there's some controversy over whether one of them is a figurine or not, but you know, we're looking at conservatively here a quarter million year history of people interacting with these figurines. And when we look at, you know, the dominant world, you know, the big three, the patriarchal religions, we're going to about 3,000-4,000 BC, just to give people an idea of the discrepancy between the two traditions. Would that, does that seem accurate to you?
Yeah, you know, Barakat Ram, and also there's the Tauntaun figurine in Morocco.
Yeah.
There's a couple like that, and you know, this takes us back to the very borderline of what physical anthropologists would even recognize as being human, you know, in the sense of, you know, Homo sapiens.
Yeah.
And so, you know, but, you know, more stuff is coming out, you know, about the Neanderthals, even about things like chimp culture, you know, that primates have culture also. Not in the same way as we have culture, but they have culture.
Yeah.
There are various forms of communication that are not language as we understand it, but those are, there are calls that have meaning and are understood mutually, you know, by and tool making and things like that. So we're looking at a much longer trajectory of development. And, you know, there's even been controversy about whether, you know, Barakat Ram, is this actually shaped by humans, or, you know, this is a stone that was in a certain shape and maybe they chipped at it and kind of ground it to make, you know, make it resemble a human form, a female form, more closely. And I don't really know the ins and outs of all of that, but it was, I believe this, and also Tauntaun had red ochre added to them. And so clearly,
I'm saying, that's huge. So clearly what?
Yeah. You know, and here's another little known fact, is that the grandmother of Willendorf, which is how I prefer to refer to her, and just kind of displace that whole Venus
nomenclature,
when found, was encrusted with layers of red ochre.
Yes.
And so the researchers, being good academicians, scrubbed it all off.
Oh, God.
Because they wanted to clean it. But that was part of the artifact, its history, its context, its ceremonial meaning, all of that, you know. And so they wouldn't do it today. They would leave it.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's traces of it that remain. They couldn't get it all off.
Would you say that the symbol then of probably the blood mysteries, is that where you would go with that?
Yeah, or not necessarily only blood mysteries in the sense of menstrual cycles,
yes.
But the idea of life essence.
Yes.
And, you know, this leads us into another area, which is, you know, because there's so much argument going on around essentialism, biological essentialism, and determinism. And I like to counter that with a concept that's a different way of looking at it, which is essence rather than essentialism. Because the ochre itself represents life essence. This is its symbolic and cultural meaning all over the planet. And even we could go beyond even the word symbolic to the concept that the iron oxide in the clay, which is what ochre is, right?
Mm-hmm.
That mineral deposit that humans have used on the bones of their dead, on their female icons, as body paint, all these different ways that it's been ritually purposed, is very close to the hemoglobin in our blood as far as its basic constituent being iron. And so, you know, it represents blood, but it also, in a sense, is the blood of Earth, you know, in that symbolic dreaming realm. And so, you know, this all in ceremony, when you're painting yourself with the blood of Earth, you're infusing yourself with life essence, you know, or you're painting the bones of your dead. And this is a very common thing to be found in ancient burials, where they would often take the person's bones and fold them up into a fetal position as if they were going to be reborn, and then paint them with the red ochre. There are all these ceremonies of regeneration that are carried out, and I think that the female figurines very often being found in these burials are part of that, not just symbolically, but in actual terms for the people that are ceremonially creating this.
I want to ask you about shamanism before we go to our first break, but just a follow-up question to what you just said. You know, I think one of the ways that our cultural expectations of women's power and of goddess consciousness going back is limited is in this idea that matrilineal societies or goddesses are always benevolent and loving and don't ever create destruction or death. And that's absolutely not true. There's abundant examples of violent goddesses or hunting goddesses. But I think overall, and I'm asking you this, not saying it, in a shamanic sense, and this is a bridge to my question, or in this ritualistic sense, in a patriarchy, when blood is used for ritual or ceremony, the blood has to come from death. It has to come from killing and cutting the blood out of something. And that's not necessarily the case in matrilineal. And so a symbol of...
It's not necessarily the case. But, you know, I think that with the goddesses, I mean, if you are describing a sacred reality, like the deep level of reality in a spiritual way, then we already know from the world we live in, it's not all easy.
Yes.
And there is bloodshed. You know, I mean, I don't, the whole meme of nature red and, what, how does it go, red in tooth and claw?
Yeah.
You know, that was used in very negative ways as, again, this idea that everything is really bad and destructive. But, you know, you do have death as well as life, injury as well as ecstasy, and that's part of reality. So how would the goddesses not reflect that?
Both
well?
Aspects. Yeah, very good point. You've spoken about shop. Oh, go ahead. Finish that thought. I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, that was basically it.
You've spoken about and written about and have a DVD and then a couple of wonderful presentations about shamanism. And I just wonder if before we go to our first break, if we can talk about it for a few minutes. This idea that
I made a DVD.
Oh, go ahead.
I made a DVD called Woman Shaman, the Ancients, that was trying to pull together archaeological evidence for medicine women, diviners, oracles, ecstatic priestesses, because a lot of the literature on shamanism, and we're using here a word, this is an anthropological term that was taken out of North Asia as a descriptor because English is so impoverished of all this terminology.
Yes.
In all the European languages, we had witch hunts. And so, you know, there was a stripping of language to talk about realities that Europe once shared with the rest of the world.
Mm.
But anyhow, I wanted to pull all this evidence together because a lot of the classic works on shamanism, notably or notoriously, Mircea Eliade's Shamanism,
yes,
a book called Shamanism, really deny a female component. And he goes so far as to say that females were only admitted into shamanism in its decline when it was becoming decadent.
Wow.
And that it was really something invented by male hunters. And so, you know, he interprets any evidence. I mean, some of his own evidence argues against him.
Wow.
Because, you know, for example, in Chile, you have the Machis, and that's predominantly female.
Hmm.
And they very clearly shamanic culture or medicine woman culture. But, you know, he tries to explain away a lot of the evidence that he does discuss as being mediumship. And so his construct is male shamans command the spirits, and female shamans, or female mediums, as he would say, are overcome by them and submit to them. So you have this, you know, pseudo-scientific approach that actually is just loaded with his own enculturated worldview.
Yeah.
And that's very harmful to women to see, because, you know, if you look at a lot of the literature, you can't know. I mean, when I was researching this, it's like I'm looking and it's like, well, where are the women? And I can't necessarily assume that they had to have had women in that culture who did those things, because in patriarchal societies, there are a lot of barriers
right.
to spiritual leadership by women.
Uh-huh.
In quite a broad range of cultures, some extremely patriarchal and others less so, but, you know, you do see that coming up in various ways. And so, you know, I always want to look for something to authenticate that there was really something, and sometimes that can take decades before you finally run across something, and it's like, well, okay, they were giving us all the impression that, you know, it was only Anishinaabe medicine man because that's all they ever talked about, and every story that you read and all this stuff, and then finally you begin to hear names of medicine women, and you start to hear stories about what they were doing. You know, and you say, well, okay, there are women. So there's a very strong cultural gatekeeping aspect that you have to deal with in overcoming women's cultural heritages, because it's just edited out by the publisher, by the editor, by the writer himself, by the researcher, all these different layers of it. It's like having a sieve, and only a few grains make it through all the sieves, you know. It's being sort of systematically called out, and not necessarily in a conscious way, but simply by the judgment of those researchers of what is truly important, and that would not be women.
Boy, you know, a couple of things there that I find fascinating. One is your presentation on rebel shamans, the women who confront empire. Because again, even if there's a sort of reluctance to admit that they were female or women medicine women, you know, the idea is that they would not rise to the level of directly challenging empire or confronting empire. That would be a male enterprise, because that's more of a warrior concept. And so that presentation,
it's a warrior concept, and even the idea that they would be social leaders, political leaders in their society. And that's an interesting subset of this whole subject. And I kind of stumbled across it because the other DVD that I did is called Women's Power and Global Perspective.
Yeah.
There's a chapter late in the DVD where I'm talking about women who led revolts against empire and, you know, against the colonization. And I began to notice that a number of these women had been priestesses or diviners or medicine women. And I'm like, wow, you know, this looks like a thing. So I started a small slideshow about that. But at the beginning, I only had like a handful of examples.
Wow.
And now, really, I have so many that it's almost too long to present.
know, that's amazing.
It's just like it's a thing, because the spiritual sphere of power for women is something that sometimes it lasts even into patriarchal societies.
Mm.
And so you can have a patrilineal culture where men have authority over women, they, you know, they can have polygyny, all these different things are going on. Yet there are still, in the spiritual realm, you'll see a very strong preponderance of women in some cases, or at least participation. And so you see women in, for example, Nehanda Nyaka Sikana in the Shona culture of Zimbabwe. It's not a matriarchy. It's, you know, but when the English mercenaries were invading, Cecil Rhodes and his South African mercenaries were invading the country, she was one of the lion oracles in the country. Hmm. And this was a lineage of priestesses that had been founded maybe 500 years before by a princess who took up residence in the cave of Mazoe. And she was actually fleeing her father, trying to force her to marry her brother. That's the oral tradition about this.
Wow.
But anyway, her name was Nehanda. And so she founded this lineage of Nehandas. And it continued right up into the late 1800s.
Oh, my God.
And she led this revolt to fight the founders of Rhodesia, essentially. And, finally she had to surrender because they were beginning to use dynamite and machine guns in that war, and she realized the Shona were going to be wiped out, and so she had to, surrender. But, you know, the basis of her authority was that spiritual leadership, and then also the responsibility of that leadership was to protect the people, and so that was naturally part of her purview, you know, as an oracle, as a lion oracle.
Wow.
To lead that revolt.
Less people, we're going to go to break here because, you know, we've run a bit over, but that's just fine. Another comment on shamanism, less people think this is just a conversation about history. You've already spoken to the fact that when these histories are set aside and we don't have access to them, we disempower women generationally from understanding their own heritage and all of the ways they've contributed to human society. But another thing is there's a resurgence of interest in shamanism among the sort of transformative communities of the Burning Man culture and stuff, and people going down to South America to do ayahuasca. And from my study of that culture from the outside, I've found an incredible amount of misogyny, not only in sexual assault, not only among the sort of hippie community, but from male shaman in Central and South America sometimes taking advantage of women that go down there, Westerners, to do ceremony.
Yeah.
And so this male-only shamanism is still very much alive and well as a way of thinking, even with as Westerners start to try to engage these alternate spiritualities.
Well, it's the male-only and all of the predatory stuff that you're describing, but also the money marketing of it.
Yeah.
And that's very problematic, and the appropriation of indigenous culture,
Boy.
Which is very much part of it.
Yeah, you said it there. Well, can we go to break, and then when we come back, I want to ask you a little bit about witches and witchcraft and a few other things. Does that work for you?
Okay.
All right, folks, you're listening to On the Block Radio. Our guest is Max Dashu from the Suppressed Histories Archives, and we will be right back after these words.
Thanks for listening to OTB, a digital love letter between what is and what is possible. More after this.
Most history passes over women. Our names and faces are missing, our stories omitted or distorted, and covered over by an endless masculine litany of kings, warlords, priests, with an occasional queen or concubine, often a woman blamed for ruining everything. But women have exercised power and determined the course of events and the forms of human culture. Women founded, governed, invented, and created. We have been leaders, prophets, scribes, and authors, warriors and rebels against oppression, fighting for our rights and for our peoples. Girls and women suffer from a lack of knowledge about societies that accord power to females in public life, in religion, medicine, the arts, diplomacy, land care, and inheritance. These crucial silences and omissions create the demoralizing impression that women have always been beneath men, which is false. In classic Eurocentric history, women end up as footnotes to the main story. Sandra Cisneros said of the search for Latina heroines, "We are the footnotes of the footnotes." And yet the heritages of women of color, especially indigenous women, supply the most dramatic recent examples of societies that embraced open female power. Even the tendency to focus on famous women or rulers is a distortion. We understand more if we expand our vision to include entire groups of creative and honored women. The clan elders and inventors, the healers, shamans, and priestesses. There's a clear interplay between these spiritual offices and political power in many indigenous societies. Power itself has been conceived of very narrowly as domination, force, and supremacy, top-down command, grasping and seizing goods and grinding down people, despoiling nature. These systems are more than patriarchal, they are colonial and imperial. Looking past these blinkers will give us a broader view of reality, one that takes in female spheres of power, cultural, foundational, political, social, economic, technological, religious, artistic, medical, scholarly, physical, agents of change and transformation. There's always much more that could be said on such a vast topic, but this is just a start at re-envisioning the female in quick strokes of empowered and formidable women in all kinds of settings, from the most favorable egalitarian cultures to heavily male-dominated societies which decreed female submission, stigmatized female leadership, and disdained women's intellects and creativity. Even under these extremities, there have always been strong spirits who defy tyranny and rise up to shine a light.
Hello, my name is Lydia Yukinovich, and you're listening to On the Block Radio.
Hey folks, welcome back to the show. Your host, Andy Gervich here. We are picking up our conversation with the founder of the Suppressed Histories Archives, Max Dashu. And when we were left, we were talking about shamanism, and I want to shift the discussion a little bit and talk to you about witches and witchcraft. I want to get into the work you've done in the book, but one thing I'll let you know is that based on our scheduling for this program, this episode that we're recording now isn't actually going to air for a minute. It's going to air on Christmas Day of this year. Uh-huh. And I put it on Christmas Day because I wanted to make a statement there, and I wanted to give you a chance to make a statement about how Judeo-Christian religion and what I would call, you know, virulent Abrahamism has had on women through the millennia. Particularly Judaism.
How you would call what?
I call it virulent Abrahamism. And so I think that there are strains of, I hesitate to criticize the entire Christian movement, Judaism and Islam, especially because there are women in those movements of faith and who don't need me to speak poorly of their belief system. But a virulent kind of Abrahamism, I mean, these three religions, the religions of Abraham, really, at least in their modern application on a large scale, really contribute to the suppression of women, and at least from my perspective.
Yeah, I mean, the difficulty is this, because, you know, you can find positive aspects in those traditions,
mm-hmm.
which is what, you know, I mean, this is why people, part of why they're holding on to them, but there are also toxic scripts.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, when you're dealing with a scripture and you're dealing with a set revelation, and this is different from a living tradition where revelation is always coming, you know, and it can pour through who knows what person, right?
Right.
I mean, even you know, there's Jewish legends about, you know, the unknown just ones who wander the earth and nobody recognizes them because they're just, you know, a poor donkey herder or something. Sufis talk about this too.
Yeah.
So there are those aspects to it, but the toxic scripts, I mean, this is why I've spent a great deal of time. I mean, writing on this book, I really actually began writing it in 1978, but I've been researching it for longer than that.
Wow.
A lot of my reason for concentrating on this thing of, you know, the scriptural religions and especially the toxic programs encoded into them,
yeah,
is because they keep coming back. You know, you can have the the anti-Semitic blood libel in medieval Europe, and then it all kind of calms down in the 1700s. There's sort of this emancipation, and Jews begin to be able to enter the larger civil society to some degree, and Mendelssohn can be a composer. But as long as those toxic scripts are still embedded in the culture, they can come back.
Yes.
And that's what happened under the Nazis. You know, and even before that, the lead up to the Nazis, because you have passages in the Christian Bible that blame the Jews for the crucifixion by Rome, one must add, of Yeshua of Nazareth. And so, you know, this is also true of the patriarchal scripts, or the ones of slaves obey your masters, because those are written and they have the divine imprimatur on them as revelation, then you have this constant recurrence, because people go back and they read this, and then at a time, like the time that we're in now, where everything is like clashing and people are in extremity and states of emergency, and they start looking for others to blame, that's when that stuff gets grabbed up, because we have those patterns already deeply embedded in Western civ culture. You know, whether it's the Crusades and we must hate the Muslims or whatever it is, you know,
right.
that those behaviors are around us. They're in the movies. They're in the novels. They're just out there all kinds of different ways. And so they get revived. And I recently found some posters that rolled up posters coming out of a movie theater. And there was a movie that I hadn't heard about that was called The Last Witch Hunter. And it has this guy who is like, you know, it's a tough guy movie. It's kind of like a Rambo thing, except he's got this witch hunting gun in his hand, and he's walking, looking very menacing down a dark street. And it's a witch hunting, you know, he's the hero.
Right.
And so, you know, all of this is propagated through the means of culture. And this is also a reason why the arts aren't so important from the other side for us, is to have culture that takes compassion and awareness and, you know, caring about other human beings, and that's the starting point. That's the basis for it, rather than these things that say we must fight the evil other. So, anyway, that's in relation to what you were saying about the Abrahamic religions, but there is also, you know, I spent a lot of time working on this series. It was a book, and then it was chapters became volumes, because it just kept growing. I felt like I needed to know more, and I was still looking for answers to certain questions that were very difficult to find material about. And then as more and more time went by, I began assembling, you know, a lot of documentation, a lot of evidence for these dynamics that I saw going on.
Yeah.
But, you know, it was a process to really discover what happened in Europe. I mean, we can talk about the older layers of what happened with the Bronze Age societies or even the Abrahamic religions, but there was a very specific development that happened because of Roman Empire. And the way that the Roman Empire, once it decreed that Christianity was the sole legal religion.
And this was under Constantine, yes.
All other religions are religio illicita. They're illegitimate. They're illegal. And you have this authoritarian, patriarchal Roman state, a slave-holding society, too. Turning Christianity and shaping it, all the canons, and even the form that the scriptures took, were really shaped by men who were of this empire and of this authoritarian, patriarchal mindset. So something very different from the Christian women in Bulgaria or Arabia, who were Coloridians and were worshiping Mary with little loaves that they made on altars, very much like the old goddess culture.
Right.
You know? I mean, there were various strands, but why it took the form that it did, and, you know, under Constantine you have the growth of the crucifix, the execution by torture of you can't really call Yeshua of Nazareth the founder of Christianity. I would put that to Paul.
To Paul, who was no friend of women either.
Right. So anyway, all of this is all the backstory. But then when you come in after the fall of the Roman Empire, there's still all this imperial prestige to those scripts of domination, and you begin to see the clergy as the representations, the representatives of Romanism, who are leading a cultural war against the ethnic folk religions in Europe,
which were still mostly passed down by women at that point.
Well, you know, some of it was women's culture. You know, there were male strands as well, and I have to say these are not egalitarian societies. These are Indo-European cultures, so I'm not idealizing them.
Right.
But there were many things they still had that were, when you went into the Middle Ages and when you came out of the Middle Ages, you know, there were net losses sustained of beautiful things in those cultures, including aspects of shamanic culture, shamanic spiritual arts that had been driven down. And it's amazing, actually, the degree to which some of that survived in little pockets, little marginal corners, ethnic corners of Europe. You know, so I've seen a lot of ceremonial objects from, say, Sweden that are very comparable to medicine bags or shamanic sucking tubes used in other parts of the world. But there's basically, it's like a cultural revolution led by the clergy and a process of repression. And in that process, everything pagan or heathen is demonized. The goddesses that were still part of the folk culture are also demonized and eventually are turned into a male devil, which is when we have the mythology of the demonological witch hunts. There's no more goddess. It's women who go with the devil.
Yes.
Right. And I'm not really talking about that in the current volume that just came out, which is called Witches and Pagans,
right,
Women in European Folk Religion, because that's dealing with the period between 700 and 1100, where you still have a lot of pagan survivals happening.
So the devil worship brand doesn't come until after 1100?
Well, it does, actually, but, you know, not among the people. The clergy are from the beginning. I mean, already in the 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th century, they are continuing this drumbeat of, you know, these people are worshiping the devil. They have that framework in their minds very clearly, but to get the commoners to accept that framework, that was the struggle.
Yeah,
and
you know what?
Ultimately, that gets also turned when Europe goes to colonize the rest of the world. That diabolist template of anybody but Christians are worshiping the devil becomes a colonial tool, a very useful one.
Well, that's a very good point. You actually have a follow-up question about the economics of it. But before that, you mentioned that ridiculous movie, you know, The Last Witch Hunter. And I, you know, I have a couple questions for you a little later before we end about the current election cycle, but if you want to even get into that. But there was a meme going around for a while from some Sanders supporters in the day that said, "Burn the witch," B-E-R-N.
Ooh.
And and it was and again I on the Facebook and Twitter I keep trying to say to folks you know, regardless of you know, what candidate you support, if you're a lefty and you support Bernie or Jill Stein or whatever, how we talk about our opposition to Hillary Clinton has effects downwind for how we talk about other women.
Absolutely.
When we talk about how she smiles and how her tone of voice and what she's wearing and her hair, we're saying we have the right to say that to every other woman in our society.
Yeah, you know, and there was a lot of commentary, you know, because around the misogyny of what they called the Bernie bros.
Yeah.
And I personally was supporting Bernie because of his positions on the issues.
Yes.
For policy reasons, not least the militarism that Clinton, you know, the hawkishness of Clinton's positions and also economically.
Which is ultimately going to hurt women around the world more.
But you know, it's just like, it's very damaging because actually that sexism hurt the ability to convince many people, and especially women, of the reasons that, you know, they wanted to support Bernie.
Yes, that's true.
It just locked them off because they saw what was patently sexism. It was, and it is.
Yes.
You know, I see it continuing of misogynist attitudes. And I'm extremely critical of Clinton, but at this stage, well, you know, we're talking about the election, but, you know, Trump must be stopped.
Yes, well, there's not, there's absolutely, but the, and the reason I bring it up, I mean, there's actually several reasons, but I think it's so important what you do, because I think a lot of people really don't know the history of witches and witch hunts, and if they did, they wouldn't make jokes or talk about these things lightly, because, mm-hmm. you know, if they knew about the Malus Malfectorum or something, right, and I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, I think I am, this, you know, this witch...
Malfectorum, yeah.
Yeah, this, I forgot what that translates into, but it's like the
hammer
break,
of the witches.
The hammer of the witches, right. And how horrific, I mean, the research that I've done shows that in certain German villages, every woman in the town was killed at the height of this.
Well, you know, there were records of villages where only two women were left in
right.
Germany.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that was not necessarily the pattern everywhere, but there was, you know, this massive hunt. And, you know, we have to think about what the impact of even, you know, I've heard, with lynchings in the United States, I've heard the figure of 3,000. The numbers vary like they do with witch hunts.
Right.
But even that number of lynchings, and many of them not being recorded, of course, caused a tremendous... I mean, that's terror. And that's why I refer to what happened between, especially... You know, there's really 1,000 years of witch persecution in
wow.
Europe that we know about, that we can track. But I refer to it as the burning terror.
Yeah,
you know, because it fundamentally changed and shaped European culture and attitudes and behaviors and values affecting women, and including the Andrew Dworkin describes this behavior that I think is very much still with us in female socialization. Take her, not me. You know, and I think that's a profound insight about some of the legacies, behavioral legacies of this, because, you know, it's so far-reaching, and it has never been digested.
And that absolutely...
There's never been a truth and reconciliation process that says, well, all these things went on, here was their impact.
And what a way to break that female solidarity that you were talking about at the beginning of the program.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, there
it is. I've had people say to me, well, you know, that some of the witch hunts were happening in places where it seemed like the status of women was better. And I think that that's part of this process of breaking the ethnic cultures. Because in places like Scotland or the Basque countries, they had very severe witch hunts. And I think it's partly because the women had a previous cultural pattern of being very self-assertive. And, you know, that there was an attack on that for that reason.
There's a wonderful scholar named Carolyn Walker Bynum who writes about women's faith and women's history in specifically Catholic nuns in the time period. And she writes, I, through her, found out about a woman named Marguerite Poiret. I don't know if you know that name.
What's the name?
Marguerite Poiret.
Poiret. Oh, Marguerite Poiret, yeah.
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. She wrote The Mirror of Simple Souls. And which was a book that basically said, I mean, she was a mystic, and she said, you know, any individual does not need popes or priests or councils to get to
right.
connect directly to the transcendence. And anybody saying this is in danger of being burned alive. But if a woman says this, you can think about it. And she was, I believe, the first person burned at the stake in the French Inquisition. And it's remarkable when you...
She was burned at the stake in something like 1307.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right.
The Inquisition... in France. And, you know, the thing was, I mean, here's an example, because this woman was a Christian, but she was a mystic, and she was a dreamer, and her whole thing was love.
Yeah.
You know, and she was one of the founders of a movement that came out of the Beguines.
Yes.
The Lay Sisters, right? So this was a women's movement in medieval Europe that starts in the 1200s and continues for a little while there. And they were independent of the priests.
Yes.
Especially, you know, certain parts of Europe more so than others. But, you know, they did not necessarily, they were not under the control of a priest overseeing a convent. They were lay women, and so they came and went if they wanted to, and they sometimes founded hospitals and did a lot of, you know, social work, basically, or you know, compassionate social action.
Yeah.
And the movement of the free spirits, from what I see, arose out of them. This was a heresy that the Inquisition went after in the early 1300s, the free spirit heresy.
Wow.
And basically they're saying the body is good, you know, and sinfulness. It's much more about these political patterns and these corrupt corruptions of society than it is about our essential nature.
Yeah.
You know? And so, of course, that was heresy, just as, you know, saying that you don't need a priestess mediator between you and the divine is a heresy. It would really threaten the economic and social power of the church for people to say these things, just as they were repressing people who actually had copies of the Bible. It was illegal to have the Bible.
Right, to read it for yourself.
in the vernacular, even more so, because that was proprietary information controlled by the clergy. It was a very authoritarian pattern.
You've spoken to, and I think, you know, I have just a couple more questions about witches. If people want to know more, they can come to the site and get the book and look at some of the other materials. But you've spoken very eloquently, I think, to some of the ecclesiastical reasons. Again, there's much more in the book. But my very limited research on this, on, again, these burning terror, the burning terror, as you call it, so accurately, says that there was, as you just spoke to, a financial component as well. And I remember reading a story once about how if a widow owned property and someone wanted to take it from her, they could just simply accuse her of being a witch, and then the church gave the property to.
There's a lot of documented cases of that.
And so there's all of this financial incentive as well to keep women marginalized and not allow them really any kind of foothold in the culture once the church takes it over.
Yeah, there's many pretexts for it. And I do have an example of what you're talking about from the 10th century in England. And that's the only reason we know about that particular witch. She was actually drowned at London Bridge, like in 980 or something. Was that there was an economic record left behind because her accuser wanted her land. And so he accused her of being a witch, and he had the king on his side. And so she's drowned as a witch, and her property is turned over to him. And this is also her son becomes an outlaw because he's connected to her. And so he has to flee.
Oh, God.
And so that's one example. But as the chapter on the early burnings in Witches and Pagans goes into a lot of sexual politics, which I think is, I mean, certainly female property owning is an aspect of that, but also a lot of very strong repression of the epithet witch and whore, for example, was already in like the 800s and 900s being slung around, and verbal abuse of women who did not conform with those kinds of terms, you know, being screamed at in the streets, things like that.
Go ahead.
Hmm?
The malice malefactorum that we were just talking about, one of the things it says is that the inquisitor is never to look the woman directly in the eyes, because then she'll be able to cast her spell on him. And the spell, I can only imagine, is one of human empathy, that God forbid you might realize you're doing this to a fellow human being.
They went through all kinds of hoops to try and nullify her power.
Hmm.
You know, the witch hunters were both afraid of her and also really, you know, attacking and violating her in terrible ways. So they would sometimes carry the woman because it was believed she would draw strength from the earth. Or they would shave all the hair off her body because there was power in her hair.
Wow.
And, you know, so you have these. And, of course, the tortures were sexualized tortures. Increasingly, as the witch hunts wore on, and really attacking the female body in its own right. But, you know, in the volume that I've published, which is Volume 7, I'm really looking, I do have one chapter on early burnings, but the rest of it is really trying to document what we can find out from various sources, whether they're Latin or Norse or Anglo-Saxon, about what the actual ceremonial practices were, what did the culture look like, who were the goddesses, who were the wise women, what titles were they known by, because that's really interesting after we've been given this whole spiel about the demonic witch and the harm doers and devil worshippers, to find out that in the folk cultures of Europe, the names for witches really track much more with the idea of wise woman, prophet, diviner, healer, shapeshifter, herbalist. And so you're seeing more the texture. This is something we've really been separated from, because all of this information, a lot of it is linguistic, so it's really the realm of specialists. And ordinary people don't have access to the knowledge about what things were called or how people thought about ceremony or sacred wells or the nature of healing, the nature of soul and spirit. All of these are aspects of a rip web of culture.
Yeah.
And so I'm trying in the book, and this is really volume 7, but I just kind of jumped into the middle of the series with this volume, to document and lay out, just try and weave it back together and see what there is about some very interesting shamanic practices in Scandinavia, for example.
I mean, you bring up a good point there.
They call them utiseta.
They call them what? Sorry, I stepped on what you were saying there.
Mm-hmm.
Say that again. I stepped on what you were saying there by accident.
They had something called utiseta, which means sitting out, right? Utiseta, out sitting. And so they would go out on the land, and they might sit there for days and hours, you know, just gazing in silence or maybe chanting. And the whole idea was to be imbuing themselves with the energy of nature and being visionary inspiration, healing power, wisdom coming through that process. And so really vision questing is what it was. And there are other correlates to that. In German culture, they had a practice that was called Hyodazaza, which means hearing sitting. So really a kind of a heathen Zen. You know, and this is not normally what people think about when they think about witchcraft,
right?
Is that these are spiritual practices of illumination.
One of the things I think is fascinating about the book is exactly that, is that there's so much that you lay out in it. And I was wondering if you could also talk a little bit about the women who go by night, because I think there's a tendency to think that the book is just a chronicling of these terrible atrocities, and there is
right,
that.
No, and like I say, this is not at all about, this is very little of the book is about the atrocities. This is about a period where there was still, to a great extent, the heathen culture was still intact. You know, you have enforcement of Christianity is definitely going on, but the clergy found themselves confronted with a whole web of culture. That doesn't just go away. It takes hundreds and hundreds of years to change it. And so place names and seasonal festivals and divinatory practices or healing methods or ancestor veneration, including around places like the megalithic monuments, which continue to they have a continuity to them of ceremony that's going on. And we can get traces of that in one of the 10 essential books that I refer to, written by the clergy. They refer to the sarandas, which are ancient monuments where people did healing ceremonies. And, you know, there's just these little glimpses that flash through like that of something that, you know, we were taught that in, you know, the 700s, 800s, 900s, well, you know, Christianity, the conversion started happening in the 500s and the 600s. And, you know, the king decreed that the country was Christian and people became Christian.
Yeah.
End of story. But there's all this other material that even in the 1100s we're still finding references to, you know, women going out in silence to a well by night and carrying on dialogues with the spirit guardian of a well. You know, so it took a long time. And I think that there's been so much ideological combat over the issue of were there really pagans in Europe after this or that date, that you really get nowhere with trying to talk about this theoretically. You really have to drill down, which is what I've done, and just pull up actual documentation, whether it's from Icelandic sagas or whether it's from the priestly confessional manuals, whatever written sources that remain, and just pull that out and look at it. You know, look at the names for healers, and you find in Anglo-Saxon, there's a name for a witch that's a healer, Libestre. And so the root word, lib, means life force.
Yeah.
Same root as life itself. And in Scandinavian languages, this root kind of transformed and became a word for a healing herb. And, you know, you see these different shifts happening. But, you know, we need to know. This is if you're of European descent, then you have heritages that have been stolen from you.
Wow.
That are really your birthright. And it's important to know them Not because we're going to do it all the same way now.
Of course.
But we have to have a ground to stand on. And, you know, that's also important not to be appropriating. You know, the reason people appropriate is they know they're missing something.
Yeah.
And they don't know where else to get it except if they copy Lakota sweat lodge ceremonies or if they go down and buy a shamanic experience on the market in somewhere in Peru.
Right.
You know, I mean, I'm not putting down anybody who's truly seeking, however they're seeking, but...
But ayahuasca tourism is very real. You're absolutely right. Yeah, it's another... It's devastating.
Yeah, so, you know, I mean, there are... We have to be able to become aware of our roots because I think in this period, more than any time in all of human history, as a group, as a human group, most people's awareness of historical layer that they're on is very shallow.
Boy, isn't that the truth.
They really don't have any concept of how it was going back even more than a couple centuries.
It's so fascinating.
And without that depth, we have no understanding.
Yeah, you're so right. It's so fascinating to me that you say, you know, in this period of, in this, which is in Pagan's book, the 700 to 1100, that there was still these remnants of the previous traditions. My wife and I went to the Netherlands, and we visited a church in Haarlem called St. Bavo, and it was built in about 1000 AD. And the major stained glass window in this church is unlike anything I've ever seen. It's a giant blue and red window, and at the top is a feminine figure with the belly of the moon, and it's spilling out rose petals all over everyone on the ground and all over the entire earth.
Mm-hmm.
And this is there's not Christian iconography that I can see. This is the mm-hmm. primary stained glass, and it's the least Christian thing I've ever seen, but it's the focal point of the entire church. Mozart played there when he was a kid.
Yeah, there's various examples like that. In one of the chapters I talk about the iconography of the Earth Mother, who gets into the Christian scriptures in the margins.
Mm.
So the ivory covers for the gospel, she's over there in the corner, and she's sitting by a tree very often, and she has a serpent that she's suckling at her breast.
Wow.
And so this is the old Frankish heathen culture.
Yeah.
And then you watch a whole development or devolution, really, that happens as she is gradually demonized and turned into the figure that you'll see in other in church sculptures, Romanesque churches especially, of luxuria, which is basically sexuality.
Right.
And, you know, in a context of the seven deadly sins, and, you know, this becomes lust. But she still has snakes at her breast, except now, instead of the snake being nurtured by the Earth Mother, instead the snake is gnawing at the breast of a woman.
Yeah,
so
the church putting enmity between the woman and the serpent is one of the really, really sinister things that they were able to pull off. Because in the earlier traditions, as you know, but just for the audience, there was a bond between the woman and the serpent as a symbol of regeneration and of wisdom.
Yeah, and so you asked about the women who go by night with
yes,
the goddess.
Yes, yes.
And that's a really important narrative. And this is why, you know, you have to really do a very detailed development of all of these things, because it's very, very rich and textured and complex. But what happens is that the mythology that's current in, you know, say around the 900s, that we can track through penitential books and canon law, talks about women who go on shamanic journeys on the backs of beasts, riding spirit animals, basically, through the night skies in company of a goddess, who the priestly sources refer to as Diana, or the biblical character Herodias, or in one place, this one German bishop let slip through the name of a known folk goddess that was very important in German folk culture.
Hmm.
As a witch goddess, and that is, he calls her the witch Holda.
Huh.
And, you know, this is Frau Hola, Holt, there's various different forms of her name, but it means the beneficial, the beneficent one.
Hmm.
And so this spirit journey of women who fly with the goddess is something that they're reporting to us, the priests are, from the common people. And they're saying, this is bad, these women are making this up, they're deluded, they're being fooled by Satan into these beliefs, and you should not believe in these women or anything that they say.
Hmm.
We fast forward another several hundred years into the period of the witch hunts, and this legend is taken up by the demonologists because it's in the churchly literature. And they begin twisting it around, and now it becomes women who fly with the devil, and it's a male devil. So the goddess has been dropped, and now all kinds of other demonizing themes are added to this story about witches performing harmful sorcery, smearing themselves with the fat of babies, which is a Roman-era slur, a blood libel, really, that you know, was used against heretics and Jews in late antiquity. And so they begin tacking on all of these things to make people afraid of the witches. And they succeeded in that with the help of torture trials, where you would get testimony being read out at the execution that the witch had confessed to all these things. And one way they did this is that you would not be burned alive if you assented and you did not fight back on the at the stake and proclaim your innocence. Then everybody watching that would go, well, see, you know, she's saying she did those things. You know, she's assenting to the charges that were read out for her. And so you have, over the course of centuries, from the 900s into the late 1300s, a breaking of the folk culture's consensus about reality and about the cultural meaning of these themes and of the absorption of demonology, and especially the misogynist demonization of witches. And that really is the theme that governs the mass hunts that take off in the 1400s and after that.
It's really remarkable. Just a couple more questions for you before we let you go. You've really been great. It's funny that we've been talking about, I mean, funny is not the right word. It's ironic, I guess, that we've been talking about women in sacred knowledge and as carriers of sacred knowledge. Did you see that study, the scientific study that just came out that said intelligence is passed down through the mother?
That intelligence what?
That intelligence is passed down through the mother in humans.
Oh, no, I don't think I think
yeah,
that was, you know, the mitochondrial DNA, there's a lot there.
Yeah, genetically at least. You know, I mean, obviously part of intelligence is learned, right? But the nature part is passed through the mother's genetic material. The study just came out talking about that. I'll find it and link you to it so you can check it out.
Yeah, I want to see that.
We were speaking when we were planning on talking. We for this interview, you and I had a brief conversation about the neurologist, the neuropsychologist Jill Bolte Taylor. And, you know, you were talking about how you really liked her and the work that she does. And you said something fascinating and I wanted to ask you about. You said, we need our connectors, and she's one of our connectors. And when I asked you what you meant by that, you said between the dream self and the analytical mind. And I was just wondering if you can expound on that for a little bit.
Yeah, because, you know, here's a woman who was a brain scientist who was very conversant and had to function in, you know, a very scientific, objective, linear, I would even say patriarchally dominated medical sphere.
Yeah.
You know, but, you know, she knew that realm and she was good at it. And she had that framework in that, just in a really anatomical analysis of what goes on with the brain. And here she has a stroke and it hits that very part of her brain, disabling it.
Yeah.
So that she's suddenly thrown into dream consciousness and she begins feeling her connection with everything, even the molecules in the wall that she's fallen against in this stroke that she's had. And she describes this process and you know, what it was like for her to go through this. And it really was like an illuminating flash that opened her up to understand that our brain has these different aspects, and there is the rational self, and then there's the dream self. It's the connected self. It's the self of symbols. You know, there's all these different, the arts and the music, that part of us, the love self.
Yeah.
And she had that experience that really threw her into that, and it seems to me that's her whole path, is to speak about and educate people about the fact that we have both of those, and that we can not only function in one of them, you know, which really in Western civ, there has been a very strong focus on, we've got to go with the, you know, the really prestigious way to do this is to the mind and science and the Richard Dawkinses of the world. And she's saying, well, wait, you know, there's this whole aspect of us that is real also. because when that other half of the mind goes away, that all the chatter of that rational linear mind is removed, and then you have a very deep experience, which I think we all have had. But what happens is we're raised in ways, I mean, they make us sit in rows in schools for years on
end. Yeah.
And all of our capacities, you know, the innate mental capacities that we have are reconditioned and truncated and confined in ways that are really damaging.
Hmm.
And so, you know, I've seen studies that say we're only using like 5% of our brain's capacity.
Yeah.
And that's not only just the brain cell real estate, that is different kinds of human faculties. You know, sometimes you'll see stories about Aboriginal person in Australia, and, you know, they know that their aunt in the other province over there somewhere died. You know, they have dreaming connections that allow them to access reality through other means. And culturally, they have not been split off in the ways that, you know, our society has conspired to do to us. And I would again relate that to the process, the cultural process of the witch hunts, you know. Which, for us individually, we're subjected to, and as an entire society, you know, we're subjected to that, so that we lose the faculties, we even lose the awareness of those states of being.
Yeah, that's so powerful what you just said. You know, since the Middle Ages, and so since this very time, you're exactly right. You know, the medieval university, one of its tasks was to rank the sensibilities and to put, you know, the rational disciplines above those of the intuitive disciplines. And then in the 60s, when we first started looking at brain hemispheres, there was still this patriarchal notion, because the script that we were given then is that the left brain is the rational part, the right brain is the emotional part, men are more rational, women are more intuitive.
Yeah.
By the way, we need rational people to run the departments and the school boards and the government and everything else, because rationality is ranked higher. And so all it became was a reinforcement of that same hierarchy. And what we know now is that that's not the case. Oh, go ahead.
That's the tendency that science has had, is it's like, you know, it claims to be evidence-based, but then you have that whole process of fulfilling expectations and the experimenter influencing the experiment, or just interpreting the results even in ways that are based on their own biases.
Yeah, that's a very good point.
And their own worldview.
And so, I love that she brings the scholarship along with it, and so she has that connected self. And I'm sure you probably know this, but the corpus callosum that connects the two sides of the brain is thicker in women than it is in men.
Yeah.
So we got that going for us.
But it's a bell curve,
right,
too.
Right.
And there's that part, because, you know, there really are ranges within sexes and within all these different groupings. You know, we have, you know, there are going to be some women who are much more linear-minded, and there are going to be some men who are much more dream-minded, but then we have that reality of us all being conditioned in certain ways by society.
Very true, very true. One more question for you before we let you go, and I'll preface it just with this. I, you know, in prepping to speak with you, I was bouncing around doing research and, you know, catching things either through your site or through my own research or on Facebook. And I read three different articles today, all that really kind of bummed me out. And I wanted to just mention them and then ask you the question. One of them was written by a woman who was talking about how she was trying to talk about rape culture with her own two teenage sons and failing terribly because they weren't responding, and they were completely shutting her down to her because, as she puts it, she was they're afraid to step away too much from toxic masculinity for fear of being shamed by their friends. And so she's talking
about... Peer pressure is major dynamic there.
And then the other article I read said that in the past couple of years, there's been something like 600 bills introduced on the state level to abolish to either limit or abolish women's access to safe and affordable reproductive care.
Mm-hmm.
And then the third thing that happened is a dear friend of mine who's a fan of the show and a wonderful writer named Kirsten Larson put a Facebook post up saying that, you know, she hasn't been able to post anything lately without being mansplained, without having a man come tell her she was wrong and this is what she needs to be thinking about and this is how she needs to be talking. And so the question now is, in that context, from your perspective, how do How do men become better advocates? What do we need to do to be better advocates and allies without mansplaining, appropriating, or taking over women's space?
Yeah. Well, I mean, for starters, listen, you know, because I think a lot of that tendency to come in and take over the conversation and what you really mean is this and you don't know that about that and I'm going to tell you what it is, is very strong, you know. And I think there's a place also for men to intervene in those sexist events, you know, where, I mean, I've seen some Facebook friends do that very well. And, you know, that matters a lot. Because there are people that will only listen to men, and there are people that only listen to white people. And so, you know, being that advocate, you know, is important.
Talking, you know, to other men as opposed to,
again, signal boosting.
Yeah.
For the voices that are not, that are being shouted down in many cases.
I guess I would add talking to young men and being honest with oneself and how they, you know, like I said, I go through the world. I've talked regularly about my desire to be an advocate for women's empowerment arises directly out of my own latent misogyny, which comes from my own difficult relationship with my own mother from and including many other places. But it is in recognizing that in the struggle that's there that brought me to the reality of these other things in the larger culture. But I can't address one without addressing the other. There's no point going on Facebook and posting an article about a Paleolithic goddess if I'm still interrupting my wife or my daughter or my colleagues when they talk at an event.
Well, that's true. And yet, you know, I think that there's this way in which, you know, one of the keys that I see happening again and again is that people will go into defensiveness.
Mm-hmm.
Men will go into defensiveness, or white people will go into defensiveness without, because it's like, I as an individual don't do that.
Yeah, all lives, you know, matter, that kind of stuff. Yeah.
Missing the whole systemic nature of what we're talking about here. You know, cultural-wide patterns and enforcements and constraints. And so, you know, until you can educate yourself about how those operate, you know, and acknowledge them, then we're really in a backlash period now because I think there's a lot of resistance.
Yeah, you know, you said educate yourself, and I think that's another thing, is you've been very gracious to come on this program and educate a lot of us, but it's not your responsibility to do that. I think a lot of us also, you know, maybe a lot of times put it on women or marginalized peoples to explain to us the ins and outs of their marginalization, and we have the ability to understand more of that if we just do a little research on our own.
We don't need to make them explain it to us.
Right.
But what we need to do is listen to the places where they are talking about their experience, and then, again, signal boost. Because, you know, it just, this is all things, it can be learned. You know, we can learn to do things in a better way.
We certainly can. Max Dashu, thank you so much for being a world-class academic, a tireless activist, and a priestess
of scholar,
justice.
Not an academic.
yeah, a scholar, yeah, and what I would call a priestess of justice and transformation. It's been an honor speaking with you, and I just couldn't be more amazed at the work you do and thrilled to introduce this audience to it.
Thank you, and I would just like to mention that my new press, Valletta Press, the Witches and Pagans book, is available through there. It's www.velleda.net.
And excellent. And we will put all of that information on our website when we launch this episode so listeners can get to that. Folks really need to get to the website, the Suppressed Histories Archives, the Facebook page. There's lots going on there. You could just spend hours and hours, as I have done over the years and over the past week or so here, looking through this information, and you won't even get close to combing through all of it. So it's a treasure trove over there. Thank you for your contribution to humanity and for continuing this work.
Thank you, Andrew, and thank you for inviting me to come on your program.
It's been wonderful. Yep. All right, folks, you've been listening to On the Block Radio. Our guest has been Max Dashu with the Suppressed Histories Archives, and we will see you on the other side.
Thank you for listening to On the Block. Now call your mother. Wait, first listen to the rest of the show, then call her. Be right back.
Chinese travelers were amazed to find female judges, officials, and scribes among the Khmer people in Cambodia. In Vietnam, too, the Chinese were struck by women's freedom, so much so that this artist wrote Nữ Đàng Quốc, Country of Women, above these women drummers, and not because there were no men in Vietnam. Chinese sources place countries of women in the eastern and western regions of Tibet. In 586, Sui dynasty accounts describe a Nü Wang in eastern Tibet. Later Chinese records say women ruled this country until the election of a man in 742. European colonizers were similarly shocked to find that American Indian women were not chattel, but potent economic, cultural, and political forces, including female chieftains, elders, shamans, and providers. Here, Alequipiso of the League of the Six Nations meets with Lieutenant George Washington. Iroquois men reprimanded male settlers for disdaining female power. "Brothers, our ancestors considered it great offense to reject the counsels of their women, particularly the female governesses. They were esteemed the mistresses of the soil." The Cherokee Atakulakula, uncle to the beloved woman Nanyehi, distrusted the all-male envoys of colonial America, demanding of them, "Where are your women?" The participation of women in diplomacy guaranteed peaceful intentions, while their absence was a bad sign, as events bore out. Political office is only one of many female spheres of power. Now we turn to the mother right cultures, where the authority of clan mothers and women elders is embedded in the social fabric.
Yo hey way oh way oh. Yo hey way oh way oh.
The Haudenosaunee, or League of the Iroquois, exemplify this integral respect for women. Their Kayanerehkoa, Great Law of Peace, states, "The lineal descent of the people of the Five Nations shall run in the female line. Women shall be considered progenitors of the nation. They shall own the land and the soil. Men and women shall follow the status of their mothers." This indigenous constitution gave weight to women elders, the Ganta Wisas, who selected male chiefs and could remove them if necessary. Seneca scholar Barbara Mann states that the men's council could take no political action before the women's council forwarded it over for deliberation. Out of the many mother rights societies in Southeast Asia, the Mossois culture of Yunnan has become famous for its egalitarian gender relations and a social system built around brothers and sisters living together under the guidance of female clan heads. The security of children is guaranteed because economic survival and shelter are not tied to love matches. Minangkabau women of western Sumatra show a confident dignity that flows from their Adat Ibu, mother tradition. They trace descent from a first woman, Bundu Kanduang, and remain staunchly matrilineal, although they converted to Islam centuries ago. Land passes from the mothers to children, and husbands come to live in their wives' households. Many Aboriginal Vietnamese Highlanders sustain matrilineal and matrilocal cultures, with customs of female courtship and gender equality. These Rade women pound rice outside their longhouse, next to statues of an ancestral mother and brother. The Bapende mounted images of ancestral mothers on their clan lodges in southern Congo. They belong to what has been called the Bantu matrilineal belt of South Central Africa, which stretches from Namibia and Angola to Malawi and Mozambique. Travelers in the Sahara have long been impressed with the grandeur and freedom of Tuareg women. Some of the Keltamashek, their true name, retain the matrilineal traditions described by medieval Arabs and ancient Greeks. All trace descent from a common female ancestor. The Akan peoples represent a major mother right tradition in West Africa, most famously the Ashanti of Ghana. They have parallel offices for women from the clan level to the national queens, or Asante Hema. In Colombia, the Wayuu people live in matrilineal clans based on the principles of human solidarity and an alliance with nature, as the elder Renilda Martinez says. Women play central roles as weavers, artists, and shamans, las piaches.
белых лебедей. Сама олени, сама олени, сама олени лебедятами, сама олени лебедятами.
Vision, illuminating our historical heritages. What is hidden under the waterline of white male imperial history? Where are the women? Where is ancient Africa? How can we recover a global record of humanity? What is the true magnitude of women's contributions, leadership, creativity, and experiences? For more than 44 years, I've been gathering, digging, uncovering and comparing, documenting, photographing, compiling. Now comes the huge task of digitizing the Suppressed Histories collection of over 15,000 slides. We are raising funds to scan, format, and label the images from 125 carousel trays and thousands more slide boxes. These will be added to the digital archives, which already hold many thousands of images of women's history and cultural heritages. These resources will also be poured into a greatly expanded Suppressed Histories website with new image galleries, articles, videos, audio podcasts, and other resources. Sharing the Suppressed Histories and cultural treasures of women and all humanity across the World Wide Web. Scans from these old slideshows will go to develop new webcasts and to create streamable videos from those that have already been recorded. What do the oral histories reveal? And how can they be integrated with the archaeological and written record? What did ancient and medieval North America look like? And what were its spiritual philosophies, agronomies, and democratic traditions? How does paying attention to women change how history is investigated and interpreted? How is racism distorted and censored the information available as world history? Why is the history of most of the world usually reduced to a brief glimpse of the colonial era? And what is it we have not been shown about the history of Europe? What did Europe hold in common with the rest of the world? What female positive heritages have been concealed from us? What does an embodied spirituality look like? The lifeways reverent of the earth, of the life givers, the mysteries of birth and death. A vast recovery and restoration is going on, a healing and reintegration of the forbidden and blasphemed female, who is always bubbling up afresh, renewed. Women's ceremony, dance and chant, healing and prophecy. The female creators and artists with their cosmic signs, the inventors of Mother Tech, sustaining the life support matrix. What is the prehistory of the ideologies of repression that are still wreaking havoc now? And what resistance have women raised for justice? Why are peaceful and egalitarian societies not classified as the most advanced human cultures? Ones where women elders exerted their influence. These are some of the ideas being explored in the Suppressed Histories Archives via the website, where a massive amount of new content is about to be added, and the digitization and expansion of the slideshows on crucial subjects will make them more widely available as webcasts. These shows look at the distortions, omissions, and cultural noise that obscure our understanding of human history, that remove from view the women who would not submit, or the magnificence of the world's great wisdom teachings. Please help to fund this undertaking, and check out these DVDs from the Suppressed Histories Archives.
You've been listening to On the Block Radio with Andrew Gurevich. The show is produced in Portland, Oregon by Michael DiNapoli at MD Productions. Theme music by Moving the Mountain. Closing music by Jonathan Oak. Look us up on the web at ontheblockradio.com. You can also find us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Don't forget to tune in next week for a brand new episode. Previous episodes can be found on our website. Thanks for listening.
Are you beautiful kitty kitties? Oh, look at you out there. Beauty like a bolt, light in a darkened hallway. New minds looking at this world, at our lives, with the perspective of apocalypse children. Standing dusty in the barren highways, standing broken before the fathers who are meant to make us whole, but only lied to us about what it meant to be a man, about what it meant to be a woman, about what it meant to be a child of this doomed age.
Okay. And are you going to give me a signal when to say that or what?
Yeah, as soon as you're ready, you can actually start because I'm recording now.
Oh, okay. You mean we can start the interview at this moment?
Well, you can start by saying that and then I'll start the interview kind of after that.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
All right.
So whenever you're ready.
All right. Hi, this is Max Dashu with the Suppressed Histories Archives, and you're listening to On the Block Radio.
Wonderful. Maybe one more time?
Yeah.
Oh, it's fine.
Hi, this is Max Dashu with the Suppressed Histories Archives, and you're listening to On the Block Radio.
Wonderful. And so I thought we would, how I normally record the show is I do it in two segments, about 25 to 30 minutes each. We'll take a break in the middle if you need to stop for water or anything. And obviously, if you need to stop sooner than that for any reason, let me know, because these aren't done live. So I pre-record them, and anything that I need to, you know, if we have to stop it, that's absolutely fine.
Okay.
You good to go?
I'm good to go.
And can you hear me okay?
And you're a little muffled.
How about now?
I don't know. You just said a few words.
Is that any better?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
I'm not sure, really.
We'll try it out and see. I'm using a headset mic and my normal setup, but for phone interviews, sometimes it can be weird.
Yeah, it's funny because you would think a headset mic would sound better.
Right? Well, let me know if it becomes problematic for you. I'll try to enunciate.
Yeah, just try to speak up a little bit because your voice is a little bit low.
Okay.
And it does come on a little muffled. I don't know what kind of headset you've got, but sometimes you can, you know, torque the little mic stick.
I'm holding it kind of close to my mouth.
Ha.
Yeah, maybe that's the problem. Put it back a little bit. How about there?
I don't know. Keep talking.
Okay. Does this sound better?
That sounds good.
Okay. We'll go with that.
It's just a thing with mics, you know. It's like when I'm talking at an event, it's like holding the mic in the correct position.
Got to find that sweet spot.
The drop.
I notice readers do that all the time. When I go to poetry readings and stuff, they'll put the mic up and say, "Is this good?" And everyone says yes, and then they immediately pull it about a foot away from their mouth.
Right, and it's just like you're supposed to hold it horizontally, and it's easier to hold it vertically and have it going up to your mouth, you know?
Good point. You ready to jump in?
I am.
Okay.